So as many of you may know, these events are sponsored on a monthly basis by the Woodside Arts and Culture Committee. It's hard to believe, but we're coming up soon on 10 years worth of these First Fridays. Yeah, it's hard to believe, but yes, it's been almost that amount of time that we've been doing these. We try to present something different every month, and this month is very special because we have a good friend of the Arts and Culture Committee. Steve has done many presentations for us. Many of you perhaps remember his Frank Sinatra one, which was absolutely fantastic. He's got a great voice, and he's joined this evening with two accompanists who he will introduce. And so this evening is a very special program, and I hope that you enjoy it. There'll be an opportunity at the end for any questions that you might have. So sit back, relax. Remember to turn off your phone so we don't have any disturbance during this wonderful presentation. Crank up your hearing aids if you've got them. I know I'll be using one. And just relax and enjoy the music. Thank you again.
Good to be back here. The last time I was here, it was raining. And we did an Irish immigrant piece with another lady who was with us that night. And then I think we did a fiddler show. So we've been here a few times, maybe even as far back as 18 years. Anyway, tonight we have a special guest. Once upon a time, Jennifer Mitchell was Jennifer, and she was a student in my ninth grade class at Menlo. And she called me Mr. Gill, and I called her Jennifer. Now, she calls me Steve, and I call her Jen. Times have changed. Jen and I have done a lot of mini concerts over the years, Gershwin, Cole Porter, Rodgers and Hammerstein, in very different places. And since then, of course, she's gone on to bigger and better things, singing with San Francisco Symphony, as some of you know, and also with Lamplighters, and has played all kinds of Rodgers and Hammerstein heroines. So tonight she'll be doing what we call Stephen Foster's Parlor Songs. A parlor song was essentially a song written for the parlor. The middle class in the 1850s and 60s was beginning to kind of find a cultural center. It was right in the middle of the parlor, and there was a piano there. And the family would join together and sing these songs. A lot of the songs I'll be singing are more of the songs that he made popular, although some of the songs she sings are more beautiful, actually. So Jen will be in and out of the action. She will be our special guest who will get up, sing, then go back, and you'll all be waiting for her to sing again. Bob Feiner is an old friend of mine. He and I did the Irish show and the fiddler show years ago. We got together many years ago, and he became more than a accompanist, just one of my best friends ever. And he's just a fabulous guy. He's a retired doc. He worked for Kaiser for many years. And he plays, it's interesting because, you know, can I say it? He's a New York Jew who loves Celtic, Irish music, and bluegrass. And that's, so you'll often see him playing fiddle, Irish fiddle, or with a bluegrass band that he played with recently at Channing House. And I think that's it. I don't think, here I am. I'm in my 80s, my balance a little off. But I think I can still sing for you. So, before we begin, Stephen Foster's always, recently in the last few years, been mired in some controversy because a lot of the songs he wrote early in his career were minstrel songs, which were actually deriding of the African-American slave. Even during his lifetime, he changed much of that. He lived in a period, the 1850s, that John Meacham recently said is very similar to today. A little scary. Technology was booming. People were having a difficult time adjusting to the railroad, to telegraph, to all these new the printing press that was, portable printing press that was taken across the country. The movement from the rural slowly into the urban. It was a time of tremendous change. In addition to that, you had the whole slavery issue. And all of that, unfortunately, led to what happened in the 1860s. Hopefully, the similarity will end there. But he made an interesting point. All of you in here, with the exception of a few of you young people, probably had in your primer music book in elementary school, Camptown Races, Suwannee River, right? Does it ring a bell?
Yeah.
I think, for most of you. And they were considered standard affair at the time. I want to dedicate this show tonight to a man who died 3 days ago, who said Stephen Foster was one of his greatest influences, probably one of the great poets of Canada. Who is it?
Gordon Lightfoot.
Yeah, I got some fans out there, right? Anyway, he paid homage many times to Stephen Foster because of his lyricism, his romanticism, and his kind of delicate creation of song. So, that's enough intro. We present now, for your appreciation, American Dreamer, the life and music of Stephen Foster. Staples, Judy Collins, Waylon Jennings, Alison Krauss, Bob Dylan, even Barbara Streisand have all interpreted Stephen Foster's melodies, perhaps as they were meant to be as folk or country ballads. Our performance tonight will eliminate the mock slave dialect that even Foster himself found personally offensive. Came from Alabama with a banjo on my knee. Going to Louisiana, my true love for the sea. It rained all night the day I left, the weather was bone dry. The sun was so hot I froze to death. Susanna, don't you cry. Oh, 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 Susanna, oh, don't you cry for me. Come from Alabama with a banjo on my knee. I had a dream the other night when everything was still. Thought I saw Susanna coming down the hill. Buckwheat cake was in her mouth, a tear was in her eye. Says I, I'm coming from the south, Susanna, don't you cry. Oh, 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 Susanna, oh, don't you cry for me. Come from Alabama with a banjo on my knee. Soon we'll be in New Orleans, then I'll look around. And when I find Susanna, I'll fall upon the ground. But if I do not find her, then surely I will die. And when I'm dead and buried, Susanna, don't you cry. Oh, 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 Susanna, oh, don't you cry for me. Come from Alabama with a banjo on my knee. Oh, 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 Susanna, oh, don't you cry for me. Come from Alabama with a banjo on my knee. You can hear Stephen Foster in everything from country music, bluegrass, and gospel through the standards of the great American songbook. Soul, jazz, rock and roll, Gershwin, Elvis, Lead Belly, Bob Dylan. They all owe a great deal to Stephen Foster. How then did Stephen Foster become America's first professional songwriter, her first musical celebrity? At 21, Stephen created Susanna and became an instant hit. Though it was originally about the separation of two black lovers, it would be sung by prospectors on the way to California Gold Rush. Going to California with the washboard on my knee. In addition to that, Harriet Tubman guided slaves to freedom along the underground. The Northern Star was set to the tune of O Susanna. It was the industrial age where songs could be carried through transportation and new kinds of printing technology. Stephen Foster's music was portable from Maine to California and beyond. 100,000 sheets were sold, a windfall for everyone but Stephen Foster. His music publisher made thousands of dollars from the printing. At least Stephen realized that he could make some money writing songs. It just wasn't done in those days. He left the county many times in his life to try and make a living as a composer. And he got royalties, 2 cents for every 25 cents of sheet music sold. After returning to Pittsburgh to make it his headquarters, he met a young woman with auburn hair. On July 1850, he married 20-year-old Jane Denny McDowell. In many ways, an unlikely match. She was practical, conventional, and not at all musical. And their marriage would be saddened by separations and reconciliations. On February 20th, 1852, Stephen Foster and his wife Jane boarded a steamboat in Pittsburgh, his hometown, headed for New Orleans for Mardi Gras. He was celebrating the success of his most recent hit, Old Folks at Home. Now, ironically, it was Foster's only journey to the Deep South. It was probably the only time he had a happy time with his wife. Here, then, is the Northerner who wrote songs that we think of as quintessentially Southern. For Stephen Foster, this song was a projection of his longing for home and for a connection that he had somehow lost on the way. Way down upon the Swanee River, far, far away. There's where my heart is turning ever, there's where the old folks stay.
All up and down the whole creation, sadly I roam.
The little farm I wandered when I was young. Then many happy days I squandered, many the songs I sung. One that I love, Still sadly to my memory rushes, no matter where I roam.
When will I see the bees humming? He looked at a map and he said, well, there's a river, Petey River, way down upon the Petey River. Doesn't work that way. So then he found another river and had three syllables, Suwannee River, that ran farther right down into Florida. He cut out one syllable, voila, Suwannee River. Suwannee River was not only Stephen Foster's, one of his big numbers, but we all remember who? Suwannee, how I love you, how I love you. Who sang that? Very good. Gold Star. Okay. And then later on in Alexander's Ragtime Band, there's a reference to Suwannee too. That was the influence of this song. Okay. All around the world then, people were singing the songs about life in the South. Now, interestingly enough, home for Stephen was not the South. And it wasn't even Pittsburgh. It was some kind of state of grace from which he had fallen as a child. And this is significant. It all began on July 4th, 1826, his birthday, which, by the way, was what? Historians?
Independence Day.
I'll say it again. July 4th, 1826. The 50th anniversary of? Independence. I know you weren't born then, but you know. And something else happened on that day that was quite significant. One must know.
Two presidents died,
right?
Yes.
Who were they?
Adams.
Give that man all the popcorn he can eat. Okay. So there he was, a very historic day that he was born on. He was born in the lap of apparent luxury in a little village outside Pittsburgh. He was the youngest child of a large, lively, and musical family. Stephen Foster spent his first years on a handsome estate called the White Cottage. Now, Stephen's father could have been one of the grand old men of Pittsburgh society, but he lost all his vast properties, partly through poor business sense, but mostly from too much drink. Son Stephen would eventually succumb to the same addiction. When Stephen was three, the family was forced to leave their beloved White Cottage. He was devastated by the loss of his home, and his life was marked by tremendous instability after this. He was always yearning for a home he couldn't have. Nostalgia for a lost home is one of the deepest impulses in Stephen Foster's music. Young Stephen was never interested much in studies. His love of music was all-absorbing. He played many different instruments. Melodic line on the flute. He played piano, violin, fiddle. He would play his original compositions for his family and friends in the parlor that I mentioned before, which became the symbol of middle-class life in the 19th century. One of his earliest ballads was Gentle Anna. It was about a girl who died from a carriage accident at the age of 17. In the hard times of that period, one in four young people died before their 16th birthday. Foster often wrote about delicate images of transients, wilting flowers, mists, and frail, pure women who vanished into death or dreams, all part of his longing for lost innocence.
Oh. Stephen began to experiment with a different kind of music, the crude and popular music of the minstrel show, part of a craze that was sweeping the country. The new music captivated white boys who were caught up in this mockery of black song and dance. Minstrelsy did more than any other institution to perpetuate stereotypes of black Americans. The black man and woman were presented as a source of derision, the debasement of their life, their culture, their speech, and their music. Yet, in spite of this racial derision, people were still having great fun. They were embracing the culture that they were deriding at the same time. In addition, they represented a popular source of entertainment for both races.
Nellie Bly, bring the broom along. Sweep the kitchen clean, my dear. Have a little song. Poke the wood, lady love, make the fire burn. While I take the banjo down, just give the mush a turn. Hey, Nelly, ho, Nelly, listen, love, to me. Sing for you, pray for you, a dulcet melody. Nelly Bly has a voice like a turtle dove. I hear it in the meadow and I hear it in the grove. Nelly Bly has a heart warm as a cup of tea, bigger than the sweet potatoes down in Tennessee. Hey, Nelly, ho, Nelly, listen, love me. Sing for you, play for you, a dulcet melody. When she wakens up again, her eyeballs start to pee. Shuts her eye when she does, once she goes to sleep. The way she walks, she lifts her foot, and then she bumps it down. And when it lights, there's music there in that part of town. Hey, Nelly, ho, Nelly, listen, love to me. I'll sing for you, play for you, a welcome melody. Nelly Bly, Nelly Bly, never, never sigh. Never bring the teardrop to the corner of your eye. For the pie is made of pumpkins, and the mush is made of corn. And there's corn and pumpkins plenty left lying in the barn. Listen, love to me. Sing for you, play for you, a dulcet melody.
was not a song sung by minstrels. It was a song that he wrote when he lived in Pittsburgh. And he had a woman that worked for the family there named Nellie Bly. And one night, while he was composing, she stuck her head in the door and she said, "Why don't you write a song for me?" He said, "Okay." And 15 minutes later, the genius of Foster created this song. By the way, she lived to be 100. And every year that she lived, she would say, "Nellie Bly is a song about me." And the woman that flew around the world in how many days, that song's about me, not her. Anyway, the other songs he wrote, though, were a little similar to what went on in the South. This is one of the songs I'm sure a lot of you sang in your elementary school primer. And this song is interesting, too. Cincinnati was right across the river from slave territory, Kentucky. And although he lived in Cincinnati, he was an accountant for a while, again, in and out of work, okay? Across the way, there were stevedores, black slaves, loading the barges. And as they loaded the barges, they brought back old African chants, probably from East Africa or West Africa. And one of them was, "Do-da, do-da, 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 do-da," as they lifted the bales. Sound familiar? We'll see. Here we go. Camp Town ladies sing this song, "Do-da, do-da." Camp Town race starts 5 miles long. Oh, the do-da day. Going to run all night, going to run all day. Bet my money on a bobtail neck, somebody bet on pay. Long-tailed filly and a big black horse, do-da, do-da. Come to a mud hole cut across, oh, the do-da day. Going to run all night, going to run all day. Bet my money on a bobtail nag, somebody bet on the bay. I went my money on a bobtail nag, do-da, do-da. Keep my money in an old towel bag, all the do-da day. Going to run all night, going to run all day. I'll bet my money in a bobtail nag, somebody bet on the bay. Now, I left out about 8 verses. I think you get the point. All right. Eventually, Stephen Foster eschewed dialect, forbade caricatures to be published on the covers of his sheet music, and sought within the best of his abilities and within the temper of his times to refine and humanize and transform this genre into what he preferred to call plantation songs. It was less about longing of slaves for their home plantation than it was about yearning of all the weary wandering souls for a physical and spiritual dwelling. It was the closest of all Foster's compositions to an African-American spiritual. Even W.E.B. Du Bois, the great black nationalist, praised this song in his book, The Souls of Black Folks. Gone are the days when my heart was young and gay. Gone are my friends from the cotton fields away. Gone from the earth to a better land I know. I hear their gentle voices calling, "Oh, Black Joe." I'm coming, for my head is bending low. I hear those gentle voices calling, "Old Black Joe." Why do I weep when my heart will feel no pain? Why do I sigh when my friends come not again? Grieving for forms now departed long ago, I hear the gentle voices calling, "Old Black Joe." I'm coming, though my head is bending low. I hear the gentle voices calling, "Old Black Joe." Where are the hearts once so happy and so free?
the children so dear that I held up on my knee. Come to the shore where my soul has longed to go. I hear the gentle voices calling, oh, Black Joe. I'm coming, though my head is bending low. I hear the gentle voices calling, oh, Black Joe. I'm coming, though my head is bending low. I hear the gentle voices calling, oh, Black Joe. To show you the change in his emphasis, he wrote a song called Nellie Was a Lady. On the surface, no big deal. Except the song was about the death of an African-American woman. The word lady at that time was only reserved for upper-class white women. This was the first time the word lady was used in response to the death of a great Black lady. Down on the Mississippi floating, long time I travel on the way. All night the cottonwoods are toting, sing for my true love all the day. Now I'm unhappy and I'm weeping, can't tote the cottonwood no more. Last night while Nellie was asleeping, death came a-knocking at the door. Nellie was a lady, last night she died. Told the bell for lovely Nell, my dark Virginia bride. When I saw Nellie in the morning, smiled till she opened up her eyes. Seemed like the light of day a-dawning, just for the sun began to rise. Down in the meadow among the clover, walk with my Nellie by my side. Now all them happy days are over, farewell my dark Virginia bride. Nellie was a lady, last night she died. Told the bell for lovely Nell, my dark Virginia bride. It wasn't about Stephen Foster. It was about a place he wanted people and himself to be. Another song then was born about home. And tomorrow, they're going to have the 185th running of the Kentucky Derby, and they will sing this song. It's a song about a slave sold downriver, but even the Black leader and abolitionist Frederick Douglass admired the sentiments of my old Kentucky home. He said, they awaken the sympathies for the slave in which anti-slavery principles root and take flourish. It imparted to Black people a degree of grace, humanity, and dignity that they had not had before in American culture. Remember, too, at this time, that the Industrial Revolution moved more people from land to city, going to somewhere, but leaving home.
The sun shines bright in the old Kentucky home. 'Tis summer, the cares drift away. The corn tops ripe and the meadows in the blue, while the birds make music all the day. The young folks call on the little kids. for the old Kentucky home far away. They hunt no more for the possum and raccoon on the meadow, the hill and the shore. They sing no more by the glimmer of the moon on the bench by the old cabin door. The day goes by like a shadow o'er the heart with sorrow where all was delight. The time has come when the families have to part, then my old Kentucky home good night. Weep no more, my lady.
In 1853, Jane and Stephen separated again. She did not care for his music career and nagged him constantly. His increased drinking didn't help either. He tried to be middle class with his wife and child, but his bohemian lifestyle and his obsession with songwriting was incompatible with a settled existence. But as a songwriter, he was at the top of his game. His New York publisher referred to him as the songwriter of America, and he was only 27. So off he did. He moved to New York, saw his family. It was the beginning of the popular song industry that was later to become Tin Pan Alley. Stephen Foster was a celebrity. People wanted to talk to him. They would scramble to buy his sheet music. Unfortunately, there were no copyright laws then or lawyers protecting the songwriter. Foster was generating millions of dollars of profit for publishers, but he had no income except an outright payment or a small royalty on sales that he couldn't track. Meanwhile, Stephen and Jenny are reconciled again. It may have helped that he wrote a song about her. Though in the original, when he got to the third verse, they were arguing again, and he had her dying. Perhaps he had wished her dead, but he changed his mind, and so it was left with two verses, and they were happy for a while.
I dream of Jeannie with a light brown hair, born like a my heart bows low, never.
time of economic hardship. Unemployment was widespread, and even the Fosters were forced to take in boarders to make ends meet. Instead of retreating into his familiar dream world, Foster decided to evoke the harsh reality in his own backyard. Hard times hit home on January 18, 1855, when Stephen's mother died of a stroke, followed by his father's death 6 months later. Then his brother Dunning died suddenly of TB. As I said before, in those days, one child in four died before they were 16 years of age. Bob Dylan sang this. Let us pause in life's pleasures and count its many tears while we all sup sorrow with the poor. There's a song that will linger forever in our ears. Oh, hard times come again no more. Tis the song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. While we seek mirth and beauty and music, light and gay, there are frail forms fainting at the door. Though their voices are silent, their pleading looks would say, oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis the song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis a sigh that is wafted across the troubled wave. 'Tis a wail that is heard upon the shore. 'Tis a dirge that is murmured around the lonely grave. Oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis the song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. Oh, hard times come again no more. In 1860, Foster returned to New York to try and salvage his career. The first famous songwriter celebrity in American culture had become has-been. A lot of his music was tossed off for $2 and sold in the streets. No longer did he seem to have any professional resolve. Suddenly, on a raw, snowy day, a young man entered his shabby one room in search of Foster. His name was George Cooper, a law student who had a penchant for poetry, and so the two began to collaborate. They sold the song that very night for $25. Even with the support of his new partner, however, Foster was a beaten man. He was hopelessly alcoholic. With Cooper's help, though, Foster was able to dash off this comic ditty, a song that may have had more to do with his failed marriage and his drinking, called My Wife is a Most Known Woman. My wife is a most known woman. She always is finding me out. She never will hear explanations, but instantly puts me to rout. There's no use to try and deceive her if out with my friends night or day. In the most inconceivable manner, she tells where I've been right away. She says that I'm mean and inhuman. Oh, my wife is a most known woman. She should have been hung up for witchcraft if she had lived sooner, I know. There's no hiding anything from her. She knows what I do, where I go. And if I come in after midnight and say I have been to the lodge, oh, she says while she flies in a fury, no, don't think to play such a dodge. It's
All very fine, but won't do, ma'am. Oh, my wife is a most knowing woman. Now often I go out to dinner and come home a little so-so. I try to creep up through the halfway, and still there's a mouse on tiptoe. She's sure to be waiting up for me, and then comes a nice little scene. What, you tell me you're sober, you wretcher? Now don't think that I am so green. My life is quite worn out with you, man. Oh, my life is a much better person. Yes, I must give all of my friends up. If I would live happy and quiet, one might as well be beneath a tombstone as live in confusion and riot. The wife we all know is a short one, while some tongues are long, heaven knows. And a miserable life is a husband who numbers his wife with his foes. I'll stay home at now like a true man, for my wife is a most known woman. I butchered a lyric there, George Cooper. Forgive me. Okay. But eventually, and we're getting near the end of this somewhat tragic, very tragic tale. He drank more, wrote less, beaten. Near the end of his life, rising above the wreckage of his life, Foster found inspiration to write one of his most beautiful and enduring songs. It's this desire for something else. Not the reality, but the dream. It's not just a love song, a man dreaming about a woman. It's what we are as a people, dreaming of something better that defines us. On Sunday, January 10th, 1864, weak from fever, Foster fell in his Bowery Hotel and cut his neck. A doctor was summoned and found Foster lying in a pool of blood. And 3 days later, Stephen Foster died in Bellevue Hospital. He was 37 years old. In his pockets, he had 38 cents and a scrap of paper with the scribbled words, "Dear friends and gentle hearts."
Beautiful dreamer, wake unto me.
Foster then became the standard bearer of what Walt Whitman called heart singing, the kind of music that buoys up the spirit. His poems are the narrations of an American dreamer, and his melodies, the voices of the heart. Thank you all. We are finished. Yeah. in the Mikado, what month is it going to be?
In August.
August, the Mikado. It'll be at Performing Arts Center in Mountain View, too.
Well, thanks to Mr. Gill and his group for performing Stephen Foster for us this evening. Thank you, as always. I'd like to thank you for joining us and remind you that next month is going to take a bigger turn here. We will be presenting a natural history presentation about an encounter between great white shark and a killer whale. So I hope you'll come back next month and join us for that. Have a pleasant evening, and thank you again for joining us.